On your journey here today, what was your expectation with your meeting with God and with each other today? That's not a question to answer out loud, it's a question just to think about. How high is your expectancy? When you go to work tomorrow, how high is your expectancy to being used by God? Father God, as we come together this morning, I pray for your spirit just to be brooding amongst us, just to be nudging us and to be challenging us and to be filling us and to be loving us and to be placing within us the assurance of who we are in you, Jesus. Because we are your children and we have the authority of heaven within us. Amen. Please take your seats. If I was to put a title to today's talk, it would be Seeing Beyond the Invisible. And before we start, well, part of this talk, there's a Bible reading. I have a young assistant, Andy Robertson. Doesn't he look well? Doesn't he look good? There's only one of them now, not two of them.
It's unnecessary.
I am trying to do the same thing.
You are very, very trying. You certainly are trying, Steve. Right. So I'm going to read to you the whole of Hebrews chapter 11. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. Through their faith, the people in days of old earned a good reputation. By faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. It was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed his approval of his gifts. Although Abel is long dead, he still speaks to us by his example of faith. It was by faith that Enoch was taken up to heaven without dying. He disappeared because God took him. For before he was taken up, he was known as a person who pleased God. And it is impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who sincerely ask him. It was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about things that had never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith. It was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land that God would give him as his inheritance. He went without knowing where he was going. And even when he reached the land God promised him, he lived there by faith, for he was like a foreigner living in tents. And so did Isaac and Jacob, who inherited the same promise. Abraham was confidently looking forward to a city with eternal foundations, a city designed and built by God. It was by faith that even Sarah was able to have a child, though she was barren and was too old. She believed that God would keep his promise. And so a whole nation came from this one man who was as good as dead. A nation with so many people that, like the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore, there is no way to count them. All these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it all from a distance and welcomed it. They agreed that they were foreigners and nomads here on earth. Obviously, people who say such things are looking forward to a country they can call their own. If they had longed for the country they came from, they could have gone back, but they were looking for a better place, a heavenly homeland. That is why God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. It was by faith that Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice when God was testing him. Abraham, who had received God's promises, was ready to sacrifice his only son, Isaac, even though God had told him, "Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted." Abraham reasoned that if Isaac died, God was able to bring him back to life again. And in a sense, Abraham did receive his son back from the dead. It was by faith that Isaac promised blessings for the future to his sons, Jacob and Esau. It was by faith that Jacob, when he was old and dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and bowed in worship as he leaned on his staff. It was by faith that Joseph, when he was about to die, said confidently that the people of Israel would leave Egypt. He even commanded them to take his bones with them when they left. It was by faith that Moses' parents had hid him for 3 months when he was born. They saw that God had given them an unusual child, and they were not afraid to disobey the king's command. It was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. He thought it was better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead to his great reward. It was by faith that Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He kept right on going because he kept his eyes on the one who is invisible. It was by faith that Moses commanded the people of Israel to keep the Passover and to sprinkle blood on the doorsteps so that the angel of death would not kill their firstborn sons. It was by faith that the people of Israel went right through the Red Sea as though they were on dry ground. But when the Egyptians tried to follow, they were all drowned. It was by faith that the people of Israel marched around Jericho for 7 days and the walls came crashing down. It was by faith that Rahab the prostitute was not destroyed with the people in her city who refused to obey God, for she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. How much more do I need to say? It would take too long to recount the stories of the faith of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and all the prophets. By faith, these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weakness was turned into strength. They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again from death. But others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection. Some were jeered at, and their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in prisons. Some died by stoning, some were sawed in half, and others were killed with the sword. Some went about wearing skins of sheep and goats, destitute and oppressed and mistreated. They were too good for this world, wandering over deserts and mountains, hiding in caves and holes in the ground. All these people earned a good reputation because of their faith. Yet none of them received all that God had promised. For God had something better in mind for us, so that they would not reach perfection without us.
Could you read the next six chapters? No, it's all right, Andy. Now, when you look at that whole chapter, it gives us a history lesson of the Old Testament, of how God used people no different to me and you, who had their trust in God, even though they couldn't see what was in front of them. They put God first and trusted in God what he had for the future for them. And you know, Hebrews 11:1 says this, "Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see." And I believe we need to be a people who are living by faith. Living in a life, even though we can't see what's beyond that hill, that mountain, that situation we're in. And you know, every day, or in parts of our life, I should say, we practice faith. As children, we may practice faith in the teachers who teach us. They're going to teach us, and they're going to teach us the right things. We practice faith in our parents, that there'll be food on the table that night. Or there will be faith, because when you've done that thing wrong, they're going to tell us off. We have faith with our friends and our family. We have faith with our employees or employers that they're going to do the work or we're going to get paid. We even have faith when we watch a film that the director is going to make sure that ending happens, how it's going to happen. But we live by faith every day in different aspects of our life. And we are talking about the invisible God on things we can't see. And you know, we use things in this world around us which are invisible every day. Man's invisible technology. So for example, electricity, the telegraph. Let me ask you a question. When do you think electricity was first invented or found? Any idea? Any years? Give it a few dates. A couple of years ago? Early 1900s. Any lower, higher? Electricity. Any idea on this on the right here? 1646. Telegraphs have been used, which is basically... Oh, I thought you were going to say something, Debbie. Sorry, you had your hand up. Telegraphs are used to send information from train stations to train stations. And they were used in the early 1800s. That was invented in 1830. When do you think the first telephone was invented? Any idea? Come on, let's have some answers out here. Let's have some guests. First telephone. Yeah, what date? 1854, the first radio. Come on. 1880. Okay, let's get a bit closer to home. The first mobile phone. 1978. Okay, any lower? Maybe lower? The first recollections of a mobile phone was 1917. Yes. It wasn't in Apple wasn't around then. Okay. Yeah, but you ate those apples. Okay. When was the discovery of TV? 1926, but very close. The first early developments of the internet. 1950. Now, the reason why I'm sharing all these are invisible things we can't see, which we use every day. Electricity, telephones, a TV signal going from A to B, all radio signals. These are invisible things we use every day. And, you know, we rely on the invisible. But let's step up the game and rely on the invisible God and what he can do through us. You know, nature is full of invisible things in this world, and the Police had a song out in the 80s called Every Breath You Take. And listen to the words of this. Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you. Every single day, every word you say, every game you play, every night you stay, I'll be watching you. And that was the Police. Now, if you turn that around on God watching you, I thought that was a good little flip there. But let me ask you a question. Every day you take breath and breathe. Each day, every minute, you breathe between 12 and 20 times a minute. The average person breathes 17,000 to 30,000 times a day. If you're an active person like Andy, because fit Andy over here, that'd be 50,000 a day. The average person, if they live to 80, will breathe
496,400,000 to 876 million. It's a big range, isn't it?
Well, it depends on who you are, Andy. Every day, we breathe in air. That's another invisible thing we rely on. And the reason why I put that into play is that the powerful thing about nature is while we're breathing in that air, our body, which we can't see inside of, there's hundreds of things going on to process that air through our body to make us live, to make us be the person we are. And that's going on for the whole of our life until that last breath. And about 3 weeks ago, I was auditing a company, Hamilton Rentals, funny enough, a computer company I used to work for years ago. And there was a new auditor there, and it's quite easy to share your faith when you work as an evangelist for the church, because they ask you how long you've been doing this for as an auditor, and you speak to this auditor, say, well, I'll do this part-time, and the other part-time job is this and something else. And I tell them I say a community worker, but I do community projects for a church. And he goes, oh, I'm a Christian as well, and I go to a church now and again with my wife. And then he asked me this odd question, sort of 4 hours in the day. He goes, can you answer this question? He goes, my father-in-law died about 4 weeks ago. And we were both there. My wife and I were both there. And it was a darkened room. But as he died, we saw his phone went off. No. Sorry. Can you please, did you not hear the message? You came in, turn your phones off. Okay. When he drew his last breath, he stated, I saw a light come from the body and leave his body. Well, I don't know what that light was. I didn't even try and explain that. But what I could explain to him was, you know, I believe this body we have is a shell. I thought, as a Christian, I thought you'd know this answer. And this shell is housing our spirit, which has been created in God's likeness. And that this life is a temporary life in which we use this shell for this life. But there is an eternity for everyone. There is a heaven, there's a hell. And by the way we live our life, we determine where we're going to be in this life. And the surprising thing was, is that obviously he wasn't a person who had a relationship with God, but it answers his question. I said, I don't know what that light was. It could be a reflection in the room, but I do know that there is a spirit within every person. And that spirit lives on forever. John 3:16 is a well-known passage. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Our first, well, one of our thoughts on God is the reason why we come to him by faith through Jesus is because of, yes, we're separated by God from the sins we've done in our lives, but also it's by coming to Jesus we have eternal life. You can't see it. You can feel it. Because I believe the Spirit is a seal of our heavenly inheritance. But I was able to explain all this to this auditor, that by coming to Jesus, he died for us on that cross, that those of us who believe in him will have eternal life. Now, Andy, if I gave you my mobile phone, what could you do with it? Well, if I gave it to you as it is, what could you do with it? Why is that? Yeah, I've got a password. I won't tell you what it is. But you can receive phone calls, can't you? You can make emergency phone calls. But when I give you my password, it unlocks you to go in my phone, see all my pictures of the places I've been to, make phone calls, play those games I've got on my phone, go on the internet, do all these things you can do with a mobile phone. But you can't do it if it's locked. There are many people in this world who haven't got a relationship with Jesus. They're walking, they're talking, they're living life. They think it's all right where they're at. But once they come to know Jesus, they're unlocked. And to me, one of the greatest examples of being unlocked was when Chris Davey got baptized. That may be sharing about your baptism, do you? Well, he was umming and ahhing for centuries. Hundreds of years. No, he was umming and ahhing about getting baptized for many, many years. But what the Bible says in Acts 2:38 is that repent, believe, be baptized, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Eventually he got baptized, and the Holy Spirit came upon him. And there was a dramatic transformation. Chris was still Chris, but he was the enhanced Chris through the Holy Spirit. And the reason why I'm sharing this with you is quite simply is that by being obedient to God in the things he's called us to do, first of all, coming to faith in knowing him, secondly, getting baptized, we unleash his Spirit in our lives. And we engage in this invisible world where God wants to use us. In Colossians 2:7, it says this, and now just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. Let your roots grow down into him and let your lives be built on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth you were taught and you will overflow with thankfulness. We need to be rooted in Jesus. There's a song we sing in worship, and it says this, open the eyes of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you, I want to see you. And we need to have our eyes opened, our spiritual eyes opened, because we are living in a world which has different dimensions. And there's a spiritual dimension we need to tap into and be part of and engage in and make a difference in. When you look at an egg, It's just an egg. But within that egg, there is something going on in that egg when it's fertilized. A chick is being slowly formed. In the early stages of pregnancy, it's an unseen place, but a baby is being formed in that body. Eventually, you can see what is hidden. You can see. But God is doing something among us. It's not a fad, because it's over a year now. Been doing gardening, okay, the last 2 years. And he knows what a clematis is. Yeah, you know what a clematis is? Well, clematis is a climbing, you actually get ground clematis as well. It's a climbing shrub. You know what deciduous trees are, yeah? Trees which shed its leaves during the winter. Well, the winter time is a time when the garden looks absolutely dead. Apart from the grass, it's green still, but it's not growing. And as the frost comes in, those plants, particularly the clematises and the deciduous trees, look like they've got no life at all. The hanging baskets, which were once green, are now brown. The clematises look like dead wood. The deciduous trees look like a tree without any leaves in it. And as the frost comes in, it becomes more dingy, more darker, and everything else. But during the winter, you'll plant your bulbs as well. You plant your tulip bulbs in there, you plant your daffodil bulbs in there, your crocuses bulbs there, your snowdrops in there. See, I know all the names of these things. Okay. Ficus benjamina, which is a fig plant you have used in the house. There you go. Right. Okay. So, but it still looks dark and dingy. But there is something going on under the surface. Roots are getting nutrients for those trees, getting ready for the summer. That clematis, which looks dead, there is something going on in the root system. Those bulbs are growing, but they're not starting to pop out yet. There is something going on. And very often, during certain seasons in our faith as a church, and as individuals, we think God is not doing anything. We think, where is God in this? But underneath, he's doing so much. When Noah was asked to build that ark, how long do you reckon it took him to build that ark? 120 years. So it never rained before. He's been telling all these people for 120 years while he's building this big ark by faith. I'm building this because there's going to be a mighty flood. What are people going to be thinking? You're a madman. You're building this big boat for nothing. For 120 years he built that ark because he was living by faith. He was seeing beyond what he could see because he was trusting in God. 120 years later, it rained. Going back to the garden, spring comes. Those little daffodils start to pop through the soil. Those little crocuses start popping through the soil. You can see a bit of life coming through. You're seeing evidence that something new is coming through. And then the summer comes. The trees start to grow their leaves back again. The garden is a wonderful display again. And remember, when you planted those bulbs, you placed them in a certain position that you get the best show in the future. And you know, for us, Positioning is so ever so important where we place ourselves. Matthew 6, 9 to 13 is a well-known passage of scripture. It goes something like this. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield into temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. In the heart of that passage, it says this, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We are people who, as we read that passage earlier on in Hebrews chapter 11, we are people who are people of faith. And God wants to use us by faith to make a difference in this community. We need to position ourselves in a certain way to listen to God and to take action in the things around us. And we do the simple changes which God asks us to do. For you, it could be a beginning of your journey. So for you, it could be coming to Jesus for the first time and realizing that he's died for you on that cross. For some of you, it may mean baptism, because it's being obedient to God. There's a game we play in this country called football. Have you heard of it before? A team called Chelsea Football Club, in the beginning of this year, had a formation 4-4-3, okay, which was a formation they used at the beginning of the season. They lost and drew most of their matches. The manager thought it'd be good to change it to 3-4-3. They've only lost once since then. Was there a match yesterday, Barry?
Can't remember.
Okay. I think they won yesterday, but that change transformed that team to be virtually unbeatable, apart from a game against Tottenham, which was one of those things. But the reason why I'm sharing that is because they're 12 points clear, no, 9 points clear from anyone else. The reason why I'm sharing that is that that simple change transformed that team. And as people of God, we need to basically go in where God's Spirit is going. Not where we're going, where God's Spirit is going. And you remember it said that in that previous passage that we're to be rooted in Jesus in Colossians 2:7. So it means praying. And last year we had a year where we were just listening to God. That's coming to God every Monday, listening to God. And as we've done that, God spoke to us about certain things. So this year we are meeting every Monday, 8 o'clock, there's a room up there which has been specially put together where we're praying together for the things which God highlighted to us last year of how to put those things into play. And as you put, as you change as a church, as you change to what God wants you to change to, it affects us as people and it affects the community around us. But it means change. We had three or four houseplants in our home which were in desperate need of repotting. Wendy said to me, they're in desperate need of repotting. So I've done that. And I put them in bigger pots, used this thing called baby bio. You heard of baby bio? Yeah? And I thought they looked okay. I thought they looked good. I repotted these trees. And it was like in 2 weeks, with the repotting and the feeding of baby bio, these trees were like totally different in the way they looked. They were growing. They weren't restricted by their roots. The leaves weren't sort of greeny, not green, yellow, like yellowy, greeny colour. It was a full green colour. It just transformed those plants. But they needed to be repositioned. We put them closer to the light as well. And by doing that, those trees look pretty good, don't they, Wendy? Yeah. So the reason why I'm sharing you that is that we need to move where God wants us to move. We need to be listening to God and placing ourselves in places where God wants us to be. There's a well-known passage in John 21 where disciples are fishing. And these are experts of the field. You know, we're experts of the field. We know how life works. We know what to do, don't we? We know how to fish. And they're fishing. And then Jesus calls out to them, "You caught anything?" "No." "Cast on the other side then." They pull in a big haul of fish because they changed the position they were going into because Jesus told them to. Let's stand, shall we? When we are obedient to God, and when we do the things God asks us to do, it affects us physically, but it also taps into the world which we can't see. There are dimensions out here which we will tap into. I shared a story about a month ago where someone came to my workplace and they were concerned about their girlfriend because she was basically a vegetable after a stroke. Prayed for that person, not knowing what to expect, and she's back at home after praying for her in Hainault, and she's in Wales. She's recovering, because when you do things through God, something happens in that spiritual world we can't see, which affects the physical world we can see. And each of you here, who are no different to the people in that Bible verse in Hebrews chapter 11. You're women of God, women and men who put God first in their lives, and you're women of faith and men of faith as well. And each of you may have stories of the past which we can revel in, but there are stories coming of the future which God's going to be glorified in which each of you have the potential of being people of faith, doing things you can't see, but God's told you to do it. In Joshua chapter 6, it's the well-known story of how Israel were told to walk around Jericho over 6 days, and then walk around it again 7 times. And on that day, the walls which protected that city collapsed. And there's a lesson there that we can learn. As we talk to God in prayer, things are going on which we can't see. But we need to be praying into things which God wants us to pray into. Romans 12, verses 2, talks about our mind. So one of the places we need to reposition is our mindset. We look in the world around us, and we look at things from man's point of view. We have that leader leading that country. We have this situation in England. We have that situation coming up in France, maybe, where a similar type of leadership may happen there. But the Bible makes it quite clear. pray for those in leadership. It's okay to question what these leaders do, but what if we pray for those in leadership and God raised up people amongst those leaders who can transform situations because people of faith have come alongside those leaders? Because as we talk to God about anything which he places in our heart, John 15:7 says this: if you remain in me, my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it be given you. Whatever you wish, but you could remain in Jesus first. So as you remain in him, your thoughts, your mindsets, your thinking become like God. And as you pray, as you talk to God, the invisible world will affect the physical world around us. Those walls will come down. God will break through. There are things, this is going to be a year of change for Greenfield Baptist Church. As we change certain dynamics of who we are as a people, the way we do things here, it gives room for the things we can't see. This wall, well, this building works we've done some years ago restricted us from doing certain things. As soon as we took that wall away, it gave us more freedom in doing certain things for God. And that's a physical thing. And there's other things we're going to change, and we're going to see change as we listen to God. That's for us as church. But for you as people, you need to be taking this out in the streets, in the homes, to be seen, how can I show my faith and transform the world God's given me to live in? How can I help these people have these chains unlocked? Who do you want me to connect with, Father? Let's pray, shall we? Father God, I pray, Father, and thank you, Father, for the authority which is within us. Through your Spirit, when we come to you in Jesus' name. I pray, Father, that as a church, we are moving and moving where you want us to move. I thank you for last year, Father, for the year where we spent time in just listening to you. I thank you for this year when we meet every Monday to pray into those things, that we will see things change and transform. And that there are lots of things going on under the surface which we can't see. But spring is coming. Summer is coming. And you're going to be glorified. Help us to pay our part, Jesus. I'm going to say a prayer of commitment. There is one or two of you here. I'm not going to point you out, but I know who you are, who need to come to Jesus or recommit themselves to Jesus today. I'm going to say a prayer. I just want you to pray out in your mind. And I will approach you afterwards because I know who you are. Father God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for dying on that cross for me. Forgive me for the things I've done wrong in my life, which have been eliminated in Jesus' name by his death on that cross. I recommit myself to you today and commit myself to you today in Jesus' name, that I'll live for you, put you first in my life, and allow you to be the center of who I am. pour your spirit in me now, in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Father God, I pray for this church. Let the fire fall down. Not for this building here, but for this community and this world. That everything around us is changed because we've walked in the room. And it's who is within us makes that difference. Amen. Please take your seats. Let's be still for a few moments. Reflect on you and God. Let's listen to him. Is the position you're in now the right position for you now, in where you are in life? He will show you. But the key is being rooted in Jesus. Spend time with people who love Jesus. That iron and iron, you'll be able to sharpen each other up. Amen. Yeah, thank you for this time, Father. As we continue to spend time together, those of us who are members, Father, we thank you, Father, because of what's going on which we can't see. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.